Good evening, friends. Welcome on this third day where we are now talking of the IC01 course relating to principles of insurance. Out of these 9 chapters, we have covered first 4 chapters so far till yesterday. What we will have a look at today is chapter 5 and chapter 6 relating to insurance customers' contracts. The contract will also include a number of important principles which form a base for the foundation of the entire system of insurance. What is a customer? Anybody who sells a product, who sells a service, needs a customer. Without customer, you have no business. In insurance, you don't sell a product which can be seen. You are not selling fruits, vegetables, machinery, fans, or any particular articles. Equally, you are not selling any services like the banks, where people know that, yes, this is my fixed deposit amount I have paid and this is the interest I am going to get. Insurance customer is somebody who deals or with whom we deal with a service, a product which gives a service, and that service relates to a promise. A promise which the insurance company will fulfill under particular circumstances, subject to some other conditions which we will see today. So in all these business activities, customer is the most important entity. As far as insurance is concerned, in non-life sector we are used to calling them as insurers, whereas in the life sector they are called as assureds, also policyholders. Nobody wants to have a dissatisfied customer on hand. So customer satisfaction is the key element for success of our business of insurance. What are the factors on which the level of customer satisfaction will depend? Where does it start? It starts with your first approaches for sale of a product, or your first approach to understand the needs of the customer, and subsequently what product you can put together for him. So your marketing, your style of selling, the contents of the product that you prepare for the customer or you offer to him also form an extremely important element as far as the customer attention is concerned. And subsequently, the level of service delivery, style of service delivery, and contents of service delivery will be very, very important features. And when we say service here, what are we talking of? Once you conclude the sale of the policy, the service relates to what? Settling claims, looking at another customer needs, looking at whatever changes he wants to incorporate in the policy midterm, or whatever else he has in relation to that policy. And that is something which will ensure customer loyalty to you. Prompt settlement of claim in an adequate manner is another important area. So it is not only one element that will satisfy the customer. It is a mix of different items which come under the headings of marketing, product contents, and service delivery after sales service. This is one area of insurance where you have to necessarily understand what the customer needs. What are his mindsets at different levels of your efforts in providing service? And then behavior of your marketing people, your servicing people, the other service providers whose help you take in concluding the contracts, in servicing the contracts, all these things assume a great importance. The ultimate aim is that we have a satisfied customer who is happy with the way we deal with him, what we offer him, how we offer him, and whatever is offered, how we implement it, how we administer it. All insurance companies will have some policies or the others as their standard products. Does a standard product take care of the needs of each and every insured? Not always. Not always. Then how do you understand the needs of the client? Where a standard product is suitable, you can always recommend that. But even to recommend that standard product, the first and foremost is understanding the customer, his business, his activities, and from that, working out what can be the likely needs of insurance products he may have. This may call for somewhere some amendments in the standard products, some making some variations in the standard products, or even it may go to the extent of combining some different products together to specifically meet with the needs of a particular customer. Today, the needs of the customer are changing with changes in economy. The changes in economy, the changes in technological developments, all bring in new and new types of facilities, machines of new designs, and altogether different style of functioning, different style of manufacturing, and different style of producing. Definitely, all these new areas bring in some or the new elements of risk exposures. Some of those risk exposures can be definitely addressed by a particular insurance product or a small variation in a product or a new product. Now, how do we understand these needs? Analyzing the business, understanding the activities, trying to understand what are the areas where the indemnity and responsibility and liability clauses of various agreements fall in. Fundamentally, we will try to understand what responsibilities fall on the customer, where does he or where will he be required to indemnify somebody else in a particular situation, or what are the areas in which he can face legal liabilities. These are broad spectrums in which we have to look at the needs. Another essential area in this whole exercise is categorizing the customers or segmenting them into different groups. That becomes essential. We will see that subsequently. There may be small customers, there may be big customers, there may be medium-sized customers, and each will have, either as an individual or as a group, different needs. We have to see how best we can satisfy those needs. When I say we have to satisfy the needs, means whatever insurance product we offer to the client should be relevant to him. All this exercise is extremely critical for one very, very important fact, that the product we sell in insurance is not a tangible product. We are selling him a product which will protect him to some extent financially. If something goes wrong, if something gets destroyed, if something gets destructed, or if somewhere his people get affected by injuries or deaths. So the whole base is on the basis of future expectation of destruction, which is not easy to digest even for people like us who are in insurance. We always feel that nothing wrong will happen to us. Generally, the customers are segmented or categorized in this fashion. Retail customers, this refers to individuals. Then again, within retail, the small and medium enterprises and corporate customers, except the SMEs. The retail individual customers, what will be their needs? Their health, personal accident, insurance of their motor vehicles. This includes both the compulsory third-party liability element of the motor insurance as well as the damage to the vehicles. If he is a householder, his requirements may be varied, where some companies today have householder's comprehensive package or householder's package insurance that may cover him for a different classes of insurance together in a single policy. Obviously, the values involved in this type of products are not very, very large. Let us now come to the second group of small and medium enterprises. Who are these people? Small shops, small restaurants, cafes, offices. When we say small shops or shopkeepers, you must immediately recall, as there is a shopkeeper's comprehensive, there is an office package. You know, different types of products are already implemented by insurance companies to take care of needs of such clients under a single policy. Obviously, such package products is a combination of classes of insurers like fire, marine, breakdown, liability, depending on the customer needs, such packages can be formed. Then we come to the little larger group of clients, corporates. Their product need or range of the needs will depend on in what sector they are working, what is their size, with whom they are dealing, what are their dealings. When I say what sector they are working, there may be big factories in the steel area, steel manufacturing, petroleum refineries, petrochemical plants, cement factories, chemical factories, engineering workshop. You name it and you have it. It is a big, big list. And each one will have its own typical requirements, typical exposures. It is always the case that insurance does not cover anything and everything under the sun. Obviously, the policies do carry exclusions because primarily, all the insurance products, especially in the non-life sector, are basically accident insurance, subject to a sudden and unforeseen event taking place due to whatever perils insured, causing damage to the insured property at the insured location during the period of insurance, and subject to the insured having paid the premium with all these type of conditions, you devise a product. Some of you may be aware that as far as the petrochemical group of industries is concerned, we do definitely treat them on a different footing in India, primarily because this is one sector which deals with highly flammable and explosive substances in substantial quantities. Such substantially or say very high flammability and explosive nature materials are subjected to critical process parameters of temperatures, pressures, speeds, whatnot. And that totally changes the risk scenario, risk exposure, and risk perception for the insurers. Second factor in this type of customers is large values involved. We have in India some refineries where the values are in excess of 40,000 crores of rupees at one location. So this is not something where standard product can necessarily meet with the overall requirements of the client. And that is where the Indian insurance industry on the non-life side has worked out mega package policies. IRDA has allowed that the standard products insurance companies need not use. They can draft their own products where the sums insured are more than 2,500 crores. Many times such large policies need a huge amount of reinsurance support. And then that becomes a totally different ball game to handle. As I mentioned yesterday, reinsurance is something which is an internal arrangement of the insurance company as to how they deal with the risk they have taken over from the direct insurers. Size of the client. You will come across a number of clients in India who have their facilities in multiple locations. You may also come across certain clients who have not only multiple locations, but different activities at different locations. And somewhere, you have to find the common factors when you talk of understanding the insurance needs for such clients. How are the normal insurance sales taking place with this type of customer, these three segments? This is a very broad analysis what I have put here. For the retail or individual customers, internationally the trend now is that people purchase on the websites, web selling, online, or through agents or call centers. Because these numbers, these customers are in such large numbers that it may not be at times physically possible for some insurance companies to visit each and every one. Equally, there may be some customers who are aware of their insurance needs and they want to understand. Say somebody wants to understand something at 10 o'clock in the night. He picks up a phone and talks to a call center person and gets the information required. See, this is something which is the name of the game to come. Today we are in that, progressing in that direction very strongly, fast. The second segment of SME, yes, definitely through agents and web selling, both the things do happen. But here many times, the agents, the brokers also have their personal calls, the sell calls, cold calls, whatever people call. And the large ones, they need professional service. Who can provide this professional service? Today in Indian market, there are a number of brokers existing licensed to do the direct broking business. These are the people who are expected to provide professional service to the client who appoints them. where the client does not wish to involve a broker, the departments of insurance companies, not only the sales and marketing department, but also the technical departments, all of them together, can take care of, look at the requirements of the clients, his activities, work out the needs for him, and then see what products can best suit this client's need. See, this is an interaction which is not an easy interaction, which is not something that you finish in one call, because you have to first convince the client that he needs it. Now, within any organization, you will hear the word internal customers. Generally, when we talk of a customer who is outside of our office or he is not below a part of our company, our organization, and to whom we are selling products. But within the company, there may be a number of departments dependent on each other. That happens everywhere, not only in manufacturing, but also in the service industry. Say, within an insurance company, you have an underwriting department, you have a sales department, you have a marketing department. Somewhere dealing with large clients, people have techno-marketing departments. Plus, you have separate claims managers, claims teams. Finance, investment, these are another supporting teams. Which one is the most important element of this whole game? No one can function without the help of the others. So it is a joint teamwork. Now within that, something done by one department will be an input for the next department. So the next department, suppose department one, it's once their actions are over, department number two does the further processing. So for department number one, department two becomes the internal customer. Now such departments' interrelationship is extremely important, and we can't really say that which one of them is more important. Unless one does something, the other can't function. Unless the second one takes care of what the first one has done, all the efforts of the person who the first team may go waste. So internal departments, internal customers is an important link in the whole chain of business conduct. External customers goes without saying that these are some people who are not a part of our organization, and they pay for the products or services that we provide to them. Now this is a general scenario in any industry, manufacturing, servicing, anything. Now within this whole game, is the insurance customer comparable with the other customers, or is he different? Let us have a look at that. The major difference is, as we said some time back, that the customers of other organizations who sell products, so you purchase a TV and you see what you purchase, you see the performance of that particular product, so you are dealing with tangible goods, and from that you immediately derive certain level of satisfaction. There you have your needs crystallized by looking at other people using the same product, or the product getting advertised on the TVs or other media. But the client has a fair idea as to what he needs and what he can afford. A wide range of products with different prices is available to him. But most important thing is he is dealing with a tangible thing which immediately gives him some pleasure, some satisfaction. Other services like banking, he sees the money personally, and he definitely knows that if he invests, suppose in a fixed deposit, how much of interest will he get back after a particular period, maybe 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, whatever he chooses to invest for. Whereas the insurance product, we have to convince him that if you at all you meet with a calamity, you require to be protected financially. If you meet with an accident, you require to be protected financially. If your vehicle meets with an accident, or if it hits somebody else and causes some liability, you need to insure. See, all these things, you are trying to show him that you will be benefited by insurance product or the promise given by insurance product only when you meet with a tragedy, only when you meet with an accident, an undesired event. And that is something which is very difficult to digest. The first psychological barrier for all of us, including us, is that nothing wrong will happen to me. That is a wishful thinking. And that becomes extremely difficult for an insurance salesman to convince a client as to why this particular product is beneficial to him, is advantageous for him to have. In life insurance and non-life insurance, there is a little difference. In life insurance, the policy periods are longer. The person pays maybe in agreed installments, quarterly, annually, monthly, or whatever decided frequency. And if he survives that period of insurance, he knows what amount he is going to get back. In non-life insurance, majority of the insurance policies are on the annual basis. If nothing goes wrong in that annual period, what does he get back? Nothing. His premium simply goes away. Now, this is one extremely important area for all marketing salespeople to look at. Now, these difficulties in marketing. Can you always say, suppose you are a life insurance policy agent, can you always go on telling the client that, sir, you have to die one day, if you die within this period, your wife or your son or anybody who is your who inherits your rights or property, they will get a benefit. And the gentleman feels, what is coming to me? My premium will go. I will pay from my pocket, though it is his own family. But still, that type of the difference which the tangible products give him, pleasure which give them, is not available immediately from a non-tangible product. What can come to your help is where the insurance companies have settled claims in the past, and those clients can give either a lip service which will be helpful to you in saying that, okay, yes, people need this. Say somewhere there were floods, there were earthquakes, and a number of hundreds of insureds got paid through the insurance companies. So an insurance selling person, marketing person, should be aware of these areas. That is where he can make a difference to a customer who is different than customers who purchase tangible products. In non-life insurance, there are certain necessities or compulsions by which people go for insurance. See, we are talking of two different things. One is somebody is compelled by law to purchase, or there is a necessity created for him to purchase a product. that necessity can come arising out of a loan taken by him, say housing loan, and the bank or the financial institute which gives the loan ask him to purchase a fire policy for the house for which a loan is given. A third party liability policy for a motor vehicle is compulsory by law. A public liability insurance policy is compulsory by law to those people who handle hazardous substances. See, this new enactment had come after the Bhopal gas tragedy. So these are compulsions and necessities coming from either the law or the financiers, lenders, banks, this type of entities. Or it may also come out of certain contracts which the insured enters into. Say if I can give you an example of a construction contractor. He takes contracts from other people and does some construction activity on their behalf. And those owners of those facilities, they require that the contractor should take insurance during construction of the entire civil works, whatever they have offered him for construction. So these are the three criteria: compulsion by law, necessity by circumstances, and contract conditions. Life insurance is the fear of death that makes a sell. Will you get all customers of the same thinking? Their mindsets will be different. Their thinking abilities, thinking processes, thinking contents will differ from person to person. If we talk of life insurance, the mindset of the person who buys the policy, what is this mindset? Here, I have some few policies taken some years back. My focus was to save on income tax because I got some deduction in the or exemptions in the income tax calculated premium, the income calculation by investing in life insurance. So there was an incentive for me. But otherwise, what is the incentive for the buyer? What is the mindset of this buyer? He only feels that he is shelling out money. There is nothing immediately coming in his hand. If he gives 1,000 rupees per month or 1,000 rupees in a quarter as an insurance premium for life policy, he will always think what he can do in those 1,000 rupees differently. What can he purchase? What can he get as tangible products for his household? Maybe he can purchase some good clothes, he can purchase some white goods, he can purchase some ornaments for his wife, whatever way. But at that stage of purchasing the policy, the buyer's mindset is entirely different. When the policy matures and this gentleman survives the entire period of the policy, see, this is one area. Maybe the policy period is 20 years. After 20 years of policy getting over, he feels happy that yes, now he is getting a lump sum amount with some bonuses added. And he may feel that yes, he has done a wise decision. So his mindset at the time of buying the insurance, at the time of receiving the maturity proceeds, are different stages, different styles. Unfortunately, if he dies, and either his wife or son or daughter, somebody has to receive his claim from the insurance company. Their mindset is much different than these two earlier stages. They will be happy to receive the money from insurance company, but equally there may be some feeling that they are being paid less. So this is a mixed mindset, mixed feeling. One way they are happy that they are getting something as a compensation for death of a bread earner of their family. Other way, they feel that there should have been something much more larger compensation coming their way. So these are three different sets, mindsets for life insurance buyers and the subsequent people who make claims and receive maturity proceeds. What about non-life? At the time of buying, we saw either he buys out of compulsion, necessity, or some other reasons. Whatever way he buys, he always feels that there is only drain on his pocket. And at the time when he makes a claim and unfortunate incident occurs, accident takes place, his property gets damaged, at that time he will always feel that there should have been a larger compensation from the insurance company. Now, dealing with such mindsets at different levels of the policy and periods of policy and subsequent claim processing is a non-standard situation. When I say non-standard situation, means it varies from person to person. You can't expect the same type of reactions from all people. And within this, our marketing fellows have to find a way where he has always a satisfied customer on his hand. Nobody wants a dissatisfied customer on his hand. That goes without saying. Especially when our products are sold by people who create confidence in the minds of the purchasers, buyers, about the necessity of the product and creating a feeling that yes, they are being treated properly. Let us look at these factors which tell you what are the parameters for customer satisfaction. If the customer feels that he is being ignored by the insurance company, he will never be happy, whatever stage. What he needs or what he cares for is recognition and respect. He should not develop a feeling that he is being ignored. We see some advertisement on TV that an insurance company is canvassing about their capabilities and style of claim settlement, comparing with somebody who is not efficient. If somebody is not efficient in looking at the client's requirements, client may develop a feeling that he is being ignored. The client should never develop a feeling that by asking him to pay a particular amount of premium, the insurance agent or the broker or the insurance company's marketing staff is taking advantage of him. See, this type of feeling will come because he doesn't see a tangible product. The servicing people have to always make sure the client feels that he is cared for. See, these are the parameters. And most importantly, they should always feel that I have a proper professional advisor who can take care of, who can properly guide me, adequately advise me on my needs, plus whatever changes are taking place in the insurance sector, which is also developing fast, and try to see that I am always at a better stage and properly protected. If these parameters can be fully taken care of, mind you, you will always have a customer who is loyal to you. See, there can be a situation where the customer will feel that the price of the product becomes a secondary item for him. All these parameters tell him that he is being looked after by people who care for him, they understand his business, they respect him, and they can work out the best solutions for him. This is the game of selling confidences. Who can satisfy an insurance customer? See, we talked some time back of the call centers. Take as an extreme case, if one of the call center guys, he does not respond to a client on phone in a polite manner. The customer does not know this call center guy. He does not know who is this call center. He only knows that this is the insurance company to whom I contacted. And that gives a bad name to the insurance company. And that is where it is important to analyze, rate the service performance levels of these people who are expected to provide different levels of services to different clients. Agents. We saw yesterday that agent works for a particular company. He brings in business from different clients for this company and he gets remunerated by the insurance company. Next stage is the broker, or the another item is the broker. The broker is appointed by the insured, by the client. And if you look at the IRDA website and you look at the broking regulations, it clearly spells out what are the duties and functions of direct brokers, composite reinsurance brokers and composite brokers. Within that, apart from financial criteria, qualification and eligibility criteria, there is also a chapter on code of conduct as to how should these people behave. How should they provide professional service to the client? Then comes the insurance companies and their executives themselves. What image you project before a client? You don't have to necessarily always be in a tie and suit. Not necessary. Though you have to be presentable in a business like smart casual dress or good dress. Your good dress or good makeup is not the thing for sale. What you ultimately and how you ultimately deal with the client, or what you are selling him or you have sold him, that is important. Then the other service providers like third party administrators, loss adjusters, all these people together are the ones who create a positive image for an insurance company. And that goes a long way in not only getting new clients, but also maintaining the existing clients and satisfying their needs. Now, life policies, we have seen that they are long-term policies. Majority of the non-life policies are annual policies. When I say majority, some of the policies, like say a project longer than 12 months, the Insurance Act allows to issue a long-term policy. And for such long-term policies, we saw yesterday that premium facility is allowed to be paid in installment. The facility of payment in installments is allowed on such policies for premium payment. Now, let us compare this long-term life insurance policy, say 20 years period. Policy is purchased by the client. What will happen? There may be some other people from other companies who may keep on doing some wrong canvassing, wrong propaganda against your company, likely. But being a long-term policy, perhaps that impact may not be immediately felt. But if you are totally absent away from the client for ages, if you once issued the policy, the agent does not approach or contact the client at all till the date of maturity, the client will never canvass or never recommend this agent to somebody else who are his friends. Now let us look at the annual policies in engineering or fire departments, non-life insurance. Here the 1 year is a short period. When you as an insurance company get business from a client, obviously when you got it, there were others in competition with you. And on certain elements, you scored over them. All your other competitors will keep on trying with the client for getting his business at the next renewal. Now, if you are totally away from the client during this year, perhaps somewhere, someplace, your competitors may carry over an edge over you and take away your business. Now, these are all things which go in customer satisfaction. I am not saying that you should only visit a client just to say hello every fortnight. No. There has to be some meaningful, purposeful visits. Whatever way all these people, the agents, the brokers, the underwriters, the insurance companies, other executives, the third party administrators, the surveyors, loss adjusters, or any other consultants appointed by insurance companies, what is expected is ethical behavior. You must hear this word ethical in a good number of parlance. What does ethical mean? Morally right? Morally acceptable. Here we are talking of acceptable to the person with whom you are dealing, and primarily the customer or the regulator or any entity whom you are dealing with. You should not only appear honest, but you should also deal with honesty. You should be truthful. Many times people are shy of telling somebody that I don't know. Instead of giving wrong information and creating confusion in the minds of a client, it is always better to say that at this point of time I don't know this, but I will learn these things and come back and give you this information. That will go much more positively. You should be sincere. What you promise, what you say, and what you practice, there should never be much difference between what you preach and what you preach and what you practice. Practice transparency. Let the person opposite develop a feeling that he is not being selectively told certain things. He gets the full picture. Now, coming to business ethics. So, ethical behavior by people who are conducting the business. As an organization, the ethics will relate to accountability and corporate governance. These are being debated for last many, many years. But that becomes the ethical behavior on an organizational level becomes the foundation of good governance. Many times we might come across some people who don't put the client's interest before their interest. Take example of an agent or a salesman. He has to achieve a particular target, say up to 31st of March. Here he is in 1st of January today. To complete that target, he may missell, he may not fully disclose certain information to the client, or he may recommend to the client a product which involves much higher premium. Now this type of things, that much higher premium will give him much larger commission. If that consideration goes as a priority, we will say that his behavior is not ethical. कोड ऑफ कंडक्ट गिवन बाय IRDA इन डिफरेंट रेगुलेशंस इज एम्ड एट अचीविंग एथिकल बिहेवियर एट डिफरेंट लेवल्स ऑफ द सर्विस प्रोवाइडर्स. राइट टू इंफॉर्मेशन एक्ट एंड द पब्लिक लिटिगेशन पब्लिक इंटरेस्ट लिटिगेशंस these are become now important tools and every day you will hear in the newspaper somewhere or the other there is a PIL filed by somebody asking for certain information under a RTI somebody has asked for information and a lot of information is floating. This goes into improving upon the accountability of the corporates as well as improving upon the corporate governance. Again, just as a repetition, customers' best interest to get priority over direct or indirect benefit to the seller. Confidentiality of all personal and business information. See, this is extremely important. Extremely important. If the client does not have a confidence in you, he will not disclose all information. He will not like to deal with you. If he develops a fear that his personal information will be passed on by you to somebody else who may be selling some other products, which number of times that you book a air ticket from a travel agent and within a week some person contacts you for credit card purchase and you ask him, where did you get this my number? He doesn't reply you properly. So in insurance, when you are dealing with each other with a lot of trust, lot of confidence, this becomes entirely top priority item. There are a number of cases which I have dealt on very large projects where large property risk and liability risk that we have entered into special confidentiality agreements with the client. These agreements were written, signed on a stamp paper, and then only the client parts with certain type of information. See, we say analyzing the client's business activities. How do you do that? You require a lot of information from the client. Does that information come only orally? No. At times you may require a number of drawings, plans, financial documents, legal documents, agreements entered into by the client, variety of things. And some of them will be definitely a part of such confidentiality agreement. Many times you will find that one particular agent tells you these are the two products and this one is better for you, purchase this. Or he tells you only from one company. As a customer, will you prefer that situation? Or will you prefer some other agent who gives a comparative statement of the products and prices being offered by four or five different insurance companies on similar products which can suit your needs? Obviously, one who gives you much wider choice, who gives much more depth of declarations. He discloses lot of information to you. He guides you about pros and cons of purchasing certain particular products or not purchasing certain products. And that is where this full and adequate disclosure to customer. For what purpose? For the customer to make an informed decision. See, as an agent or a broker or even as an insurance company, you don't take a decision on behalf of the insured to purchase a particular type of product. It is the decision of the client. And you facilitate him to take an informed decision. And that is where this adequate disclosure words go in. This definitely requires effective marketing. What is effective marketing? Let me give you an example of a shoe company. the marketing chief or the CEO, he has a map on his wall and he sits in his cabin and looks at things and says that, look, we don't have orders from this particular village. So they sell an order boy to take orders from different shops. The order boy goes to different shops and the shopkeepers tell him no order for shoes or chappals. Then they sell a salesman. He tries to canvass the goodness of the products of his company. The shopkeeper say no sell for this, no demand for this product, so no sell. Then they sell the marketing man. The marketing man goes there. He stays there in the village for a day, looks at the habits of people, looks at how they work, what they do, how they behave. And next day he approaches the head of the village, or what we call as Mukhiya or Sarpanch. He approaches the head of the village and tells him that, sir, I have come from this and this place and I represent this company, these are our products. He shows him some good shoes and chappals and says that, look, I am wearing this. This gives a lot of comfort. Why don't you try one? The village chief tries one and he feels that, yes, this is a good product. See, the marketing man convinces him the goodness about his product. Then he requests the mukhiya, the head, that, sir, if you are happy with this product, why not tell your village people? They will follow you. So he calls a meeting of all the village people and tells them that, look, this gentleman has come from a particular company. They manufacture these shoes and chappals which are new to us. So he gives a few samples for them to try. All of them are happy and he gets the order. So what is the difference now here we saw? That the order boy had a different role. Salesman tried to sell what was available with him. The marketing man created a need in the mind of the client for using this product. And that is where the whole difference lies. Now, effective marketing will depend upon what? Insofar as insurance is concerned, class of business, product development in the market, market conditions. See, today market condition, if on property class of insurance in non-life sector, there is no tariff of premiums, it is de-tariffed some years back. So it is a free competition among insurance companies, only on the pricing, the product is fixed. In that situation, the market conditions, the marketing fellows will find it difficult to deal. How is the marketing done? Directly by the insurance companies themselves, or through a broker, or through an agent? All these things together will go into effective marketing. See, looking at needs of large clients, or with the innovations in technology and science, new and new facilities coming in, it is not only the job of marketing insurance. These fellows have also to understand the technicalities involved with the client's activities, the client's facilities, client's assets. And that is where the technical team of the insurance company and his marketing team together do the marketing effort. And you can see that some of the insurance companies have separate techno-marketing departments to deal with such large clients. This is just out of the textbook. How should your marketing strategy be? It should be smart. S stands for specific, manageable, achievable. It should be relevant to the client. It should be time bound. Fundamentally, there should be no over commitments.